So today I will address you on the subject, the GPS you need, part one. The GPS you need, part one. Pray with me, please. Father, guide us, we ask. Remove from this place. Remove from this city what is not like you, and have your way, we ask. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. There was a time that people who used to travel had a very hard time to get from their location to their destination because of lack of directions, lack of information. Of course, it was very difficult. Human beings invented some clocks. They used to use some compass or clocks. They will follow those things, of course, which provided them very less information, very inaccurate information on how to get from their destination to their to their destination. Until they came up as well with some paper maps. How many of you remember the paper maps? You do? Okay. So whenever you decide to travel, you will need to take a big map. You lay it maybe in the floor or on a table somehow, or you sit in your car, you open this big paper map so you can find out exactly where you're going to. Sometimes people got lost. Had you ever got lost? A lot of time, huh? People got lost because they did not have enough information. They did not have the sense of directions that they needed. So they got lost. They got confused. They got discouraged. Sometimes you call the person, or if you're going to visit somebody, I remember it happened to me several times, especially when I was in Chicago. I remember that particular elder I was going to visit with. I called him several times because I just could not find the address. But guess what? I was just a few blocks from his house, but I could not get there because I did not have enough information. But praise be to God. Today is different, isn't it? With your smartphone, come on, somebody. Even with Android phone, the iPhone, Android phone, all kind of phones, or a regular GPS, you can get yourself from point A to point B because you get enough information from the GPS. The GPS is very important, isn't it? Even today, believe me, some people still get lost because they refuse to follow what? The GPS. Brothers and sisters, I'm telling you, I enjoy having a GPS on my phone. I don't know about you, but my wife discovered what they call an app's name, Waze. How many of you are familiar with Waze? Hey, man, somebody. Waze is very good. All right? Waze, not only giving you directions on how to get to your destinations, but also Waze will allow you to know or will inform you about the pothole. All right? If there are any holes on your driveway or on your road, it will tell you, be careful, because there are some potholes somewhere. Also, another information you get is where the cops are located. Come on, somebody. Say amen to that one. You can see where the cops are located, huh? And That will save you some money. Come on, somebody. Have you ever got a ticket? Speeding ticket? I got a few. So I don't know what my wife did, but she found that app, and then she gave it to me. Believe me, you, it saved me some money, somebody. So if human beings are able to build or to invent something as good as a GPS that will provide you directions or information that you need to travel, to make your travel easier than ever. What about God? Don't you know that God is going to provide you something even better to get you from the earth to heaven? Because we do have a destination. We here in America. There was a time I was in Haiti. Now I'm here in America. But believe me, you, our destination is not America. Come on, somebody. Your destination is not Europe. It's not Jerusalem or Paris and China and Russia or so many other countries. Your destination is not this one. You can travel throughout the world, going wherever you want to. But as a Christian, we do have an ultimate destination. Our destination is not on this earth. It's not in any of the continent. It is not in America. It is not in Africa, Australia, Antarctica. No, none of those places. You will visit those places. Some of them you'll fall in love with. But guess what? At the end of the day, everywhere on earth, you will find something that you don't like. Come on, somebody. You're going to face some challenges that you never faced in your country. You're going to deal with some crazy situations that you never had to deal with in your own country. So when all is said and done, I'm looking forward for a new land, to go to a new land, a new country. Come on, somebody. The best country ever that is not built by human beings, but something that is built by God himself. Oh, yes, we do have a GPS. By the way, for definition, GPS in our message means God, powerful spirit. Come on, somebody. God, powerful spirit. So we do have the Holy Spirit. Last time I remember we talk about the personality of the Holy Spirit, the responsibility of the Holy Spirit, and the authority of the Holy Spirit. Do you know the Holy Spirit is the most important person in the world? Do you know the Holy Spirit is the busiest person in the world? You know why he's so busy? He's busy taking care of you. Come on, somebody. Busy taking care of your children. Busy taking care of your grandchildren. Busy taking care of our community to make sure that we are safe and we are saved. Because when all is said and done, it is not the government that keeps us safe. It is the Holy Spirit himself. If there is amen, say amen for the Holy Spirit, somebody. The Holy Spirit is watching over us. He's not only protecting us physically, he's protecting us spiritually, brothers and sisters. Because as we live in the world, we are in a war. The war between good and evil. That's the war that we are involved in. We are in a war. So we need a helper, somebody. Amen? Oh, there are three things I want to share with you related to our GPS, the Holy Spirit. God has given us the Holy Spirit at least for three reasons. How many? Three. You may be familiar with your pastor now. You know I'm coming with three at least. Three or four. And I will sit down. Amen? Three. I'm not going to give you a lot. Three. So can you remember? Number one, God has given us the Holy Spirit to encourage us. What is that again? To do what? To encourage you. Because sometimes you get discouraged. Come on, somebody. You, as you go through life, sometimes you will be down. Sometimes you will be up. Sometimes you will get discouraged. Sometimes you will be dismayed. Sometimes you may even be depressed. Sometimes you will lose your mind. Sometimes you want to do bad things or evil things to yourself or to somebody else because of the situations that you are going through. But I'm here to let you know, you are not alone in the fight. Amen? You're not alone in the fight. So Jesus says in John chapter 14, go with me to John chapter 14. In John chapter 14, from verse 1 all the way to verse 6, the Lord realizes that his disciples will sometime be discouraged. Life can be hard sometimes, isn't it? And sometimes, or maybe most of the time, it's hard. When you are facing death in your family, when you are facing incurable diseases, your family members who are sick, or maybe you are sick, brothers and sisters, things like that can get you discouraged. When you know that you have bills to pay, and you may not even have enough money to pay the bills, you are having a hard time. As my sister testified this morning, when you have a home to sell, and then now the buyers maybe require more of you, or the real estate agents maybe require more of you, or maybe the banks maybe require more of you, you are facing a hard time. It can be very discouraging. But the Lord says to you this morning, let not your heart, oh, somebody talk to me. Let not your heart, oh, believe in whom? Believe in God. Believe also in my Father's house are what? Many mansions. If it were not so, I would have what? Told you. I'll go to prepare a place for whom? For you. If I go and prepare a place for you, I will do what? I will come again. And I will do what? I will receive you unto myself. And where I am, there you may be also. Amen, somebody. Brothers and sisters, I'm telling you, you may not have a mansion now. It's okay. But when you get to heaven, you will find your mansion, somebody. Amen? Oh, you do not need to copy or imitate the celebrities. You don't need to. Because all those things will pass away. I mean, you may not have the best home, the best car. You may not have a lot of money. But don't worry about those things much. Because when all is said and done, Jesus is coming soon. So Jesus is saying to you, let not your heart be troubled. Do not be troubled by those things. Do not let those things take away your peace. Because trouble can steal your peace. Trouble can steal your love. Trouble can steal your joy. Come on, somebody. Trouble can steal your strength. So sometimes you feel very weak because you have so much trouble in your life. So now you are losing all the strength that you used to have, and you feel very weak. You feel like you are in the bottomless of the earth. You are very down. But I'm here to let you know, the Holy Spirit says to you, I do not want you to be down. I want you to be up. Come on, somebody. So the Lord says, I come to your rescue. In the same chapter, I want you to go to John, the same John 14, verse 26. From verse 26, what do you have? Verse 16, yeah. Not 26 yet. Yeah, John 14. Yes, from 16. What do you have here? The Lord not only saying to you, to encourage you, let not your heart be troubled. I go to prepare something for you, something better. But he says to you here, you're not alone. I have sent you a helper. Come on, somebody. Verse 16. Let's read that together. What does it say? I will pray the Father, and he will what? Give you what? Whom? Another helper. My version says, that he may abide with you for how long? Hallelujah. Can somebody say hallelujah for the Holy Spirit? Yeah. So, brothers and sisters, Jesus says, I will send you a helper. You are never going to be alone. When you are at home, you are not alone. You may feel lonely, but you are not alone. Amen, somebody. When you're driving, you may feel alone, but you are never alone. When you are at work, I am with you. Come on, somebody. When you are at school, I am with you. When you are studying for your test, I am with you. When you are taking your exams, I am with you. When you are trying to get your financial clear, I am with you. So you are never alone. So somebody, I want to remind you this morning, if you feel lonely, if you feel depressed, you say, ask God to send the Holy Spirit into your heart. Amen? Oh, Jesus, I'll send you a helper. Remember what Jesus said. He said, I will pray. Which means that if we want the helper to come to us, we need to do what? We need to pray. Prayer is powerful, brothers and sisters. In fact, there's power in prayer. All right? There's power in prayer. Much prayer, much power. Less prayer, less power. More prayer, more prayer. So church, it's time to pray. Amen? It's time to pray. Young people, it's time to pray. What I love about God, God does not only listen to the prayers of the older people. God listens to the prayer of the babies. Come on, somebody. He listens to the prayers of the youth. He is listening to the prayer of the senior citizen. He's listening not only just to the prayers of the pastors. He's listening to the prayers of the members. Amen, somebody. I'm happy. Because the Lord says in Matthew 21 verse 22. He says this. I want you to read that one. It should be very encouraging. Matthew 21. Verse 22. Let's see what the Lord says to you this morning. Particularly, he says this. 21:22. If you get a say amen. Oh yes. 21 verse 22. What does the Lord say? He said what? Whatsoever things you ask in prayer, believing you will what? Whatsoever you name it, the Lord says, I'll do it for you. Amen. Because when the Holy Spirit, remember when you are baptized, the Lord has put the Holy Spirit inside of you. Amen, somebody. He puts the Holy Spirit inside of you. But the best thing about it, now the Holy Spirit is inside of you, there is something that you must do to activate the Holy Spirit, somebody. Because somebody may be in your house, maybe your roommate, or maybe a visiting friend, but until you give access to the visitor in your house, the person does not have access to your bedroom, to your kitchen, to your refrigerator, downstairs, or wherever. But you must give access to the Holy Spirit to encourage you. The Holy Spirit is here to encourage you, to help. He says, I'm not here to hurt you. I'm here to help you, not to hurt you, but to help you. A helper. Many times, brothers and sisters in life, you will need somebody to help you. How many times you find yourself in a helpless situation? What do you do? Do you call for help? I remember a few times that I got flat tires. I called my insurance company in the city, that particular tower, to come and help me out. And when the helper came, I remember one time that guy came. He took off my the tire that was bad. He took it off and he put on for me my spare tire. He put it on for me. He said, "Man, I'll make sure that you're okay. So I'm going to stand behind you so that nobody hit you. So I'll make sure that you're okay." He took care of me and I was able to go. Sometimes we need a helper. Do you need a helper this morning? Oh, can you say help? Oh, come on, somebody. Can you say help? Yes. Sometimes you need somebody to help you with your health. You need somebody to help you with the bills. You need somebody to help you to get through the day. You need somebody to help you to remind you how much the Lord loves you, never to give up. You need that helper. So the Holy Spirit, number one, he is sent to encourage you. Amen? Number two, the second thing I want to look at with you. The Holy Spirit is sent to enlighten you. To do what again? enlighten you. Go with me to the same chapter, John chapter 14, verse 26. John 14, 26. This is what the Lord is saying to you right now. Here, from 26. John 14, from verse 26. You know what? Let's read 25 as well. These things I have what? Spoken to you while being present with you. But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you what? All things. And bring to your remembrance all things that I said to whom? To you. Verse 27. So, peace I leave with you. My peace I give you, not as the world gives, do I give to you. Let not your heart be again what? Trouble. Let not your heart be troubled, brothers and sisters. So this morning the Lord is saying that, you know what? To enlighten you means, you know, to make things clear for you. To take away confusion and bigotry. All right? The Holy Spirit will make things clear to you so you know exactly what's going on. You do not need to get lost in the world. Some people say, I don't know which religion to follow. You have the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will tell you that the Word of God is true. Amen? Jesus Christ is Lord. And there's no one like Him. The Bible will tell you, and the Holy Spirit will confirm that Jesus was born, Jesus lived on earth, Jesus was crucified, Jesus was buried, Jesus came back to life, Jesus ascended to heaven, and Jesus is coming soon. What I love about the Holy Spirit, He's not talking about Himself. The Holy Spirit does nothing for Himself. He does everything for other people. He does something for me and also in me. He does something for Adriana and something in her and through her and her family. He does something in everybody. Amen? So He's here for us. And what He also does, brothers and sisters, He lifts up the name of Jesus Christ. He represents God, the Father, the Son. He talks about them. He says, I come to represent them. The Holy Spirit is not selfish. He's very selfless. He's a selfless servant, if we couldn't put that in a human way or human term. He's a selfless servant. He's here to serve you, to enlighten you, to teach you what you don't know. He's your best teacher. Amen? So when you go to school, if you find out that there are some subjects that may be a little bit hard for you to deal with, you need to ask the Holy Spirit to do what? To help you. And He will help you. How do I know? I remember there was a crazy class I was dealing with. It seemed that I did not have enough English to deal with that class. It was a little bit like a coding class, all right? It was very, a little bit, you know, tough for me to deal with. And guess what? I prayed. I said, Lord, I'm about to fail that class. I do not want to flunk that class. So help me out. Guess what? At the end of the class, I got a B+. Amen, somebody. Can the Holy Spirit go to school with you? Yes. When you are going to drive out, when you're going to travel, talk to the Lord. Say, Lord, Holy Spirit, I would like you to be the driver. I'm not the best driver. The Holy Spirit tries not to be a passenger in your car. He does not want to be a passenger in your airplane. He want to be the pilot. Come on, somebody. He want to be the driver of your life. You will mess up your life if you try to do it alone. But believe me, you, if you allow the Holy Spirit to take control of your life, you're going to have the best life ever. So let the Holy Spirit do it. So that's the second thing. The third thing I want to share with you. Not only the Holy Spirit is here to encourage you, or that the Holy Spirit is also here, brothers and sisters, to empower you. All right? encouraged. He wants you to be encouraged. He wants you to be well informed, to teach you what you need to know, to instruct you what you need to know. But he is also here to empower you. Empower you so that discouragement will not get you. You will get discouraged, but discouragement will not get you. Amen, somebody. That thing cannot kill you. Discouragement could kill somebody. The people who become suicidal are people who get so discouraged, so dismayed, so distracted, so distorted, so disconnected from everybody. And now the devil is telling them the best way out is to kill themselves. But the Holy Spirit says, you know what? I'm going to give you the ability, all right? To empower is to give you the ability not only to stand the trials of this world, but also to represent me. Come on, somebody. Yes, to represent me, to reflect me, to reveal me to everybody you meet. So now, because the Holy Spirit is in you, you become an encourager yourself. You encourage your children if you are parents. You encourage your spouse if you are a husband or a wife. You encourage your brothers and sisters if you have any. You encourage your fellow believers. Hallelujah, somebody. You encourage them to let them know, you know, then the sorrow comes through the night, but joy comes in the morning. So your sorrow will not endure forever. That too shall pass by the grace of God. Amen? Amen. Tell that thing that tries to drag you down to the pit of hell, tell that thing, you too shall pass by the power of the Holy Spirit. Empower you. Jesus knows that it is impossible for the disciples to live in this world a righteous life without the Holy Spirit. So what Jesus has done, not only to pray to the Father to send the Helper who is the Holy Spirit, but also to remind the disciples of the promise, to remind the disciples that they must wait for the Holy Spirit. They must wait for him. Go with me to Acts chapter 1. In Acts chapter 1, all the way from verse 1, going down, but the most important verse would be verse 8. So when Jesus said to them, Jesus is talking to them, he says, I know that you got baptized not too long ago, okay? I know Pastor Willis baptized you, okay? I know Pastor Tate baptized you. I know Pastor Wallace Central baptized you. I know some men of God baptized you. But guess what? The same way it was for John who baptized the disciples. Jesus said to the disciples, I know John baptized you with water, but many days from now, a few days from now, you will be baptized with the power of the Holy Spirit. Oh, hallelujah. I'm waiting for that thing, brothers and sisters. You will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. So he says to them, so stay focused, not on the things of this earth, but on the things above. You need to stay focused. But you know, sad but true, a lot of times that God is talking to us about things that give life, but we are interested in the things that not only bring death to us. So Jesus said to them, you need to wait for the Holy Spirit. While Jesus is still talking, you know what the disciples do? As many of us would have done. They said to Jesus, oh, Jesus, I know you're going to have the church election. who's going to be the president? Is it at that time that you're going to ask me to be the president or to be in the local church level, to be the first elder or to be that deacon? Or Jesus said, come on, y'all. I'm not talking about church positions. Amen? I am talking about the kingdom of God. They say that at this time that you're going to establish the kingdom of Israel. Jesus said, no, that's not your business. When God is going to establish his kingdom, he's a point, brothers and sisters, application here. A lot of time we worry about the second coming of Jesus Christ. When is he coming? Is he coming at all? When is he coming? When is he coming? Jesus said, no, 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 no. Don't worry about that one. I've got it. What you need to put your mind on or to zoom on is this one. Acts chapter 1 verse 8. What does it say? But you shall what? Receive power when that? When? When the Holy Spirit what? Comes upon you. You shall receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you shall be whom again? You shall be my witnesses. Where? In Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and so on and so on. Everywhere in the world. In other words, Jesus is saying to you, because I give you the Holy Spirit to become an encourager, you need to encourage other people around you. Amen? Because I give you the Holy Spirit, I want you to become, to enlighten some people. All right? To become an enlightener. To enlighten somebody. All right? To enlighten somebody. I want you to do that. To become an instructor. To become a teacher to somebody. To teach people around you. Teach people in your home. In your school. In your workplace. Or at your workplace. Wherever you are. To enlighten somebody. Somebody who do not know you. All right? Somebody who do not know Jesus Christ. So I want to use you for this purpose. Empower. I empower you. And remember I said that before. We cannot receive the power without receiving the Holy Spirit. And I do not need the power. I need the Holy Spirit. Amen? You do not need just the power. You need the Holy Spirit. If I can have a power plant, I do not need just electricity. I need a power plant. Come on, somebody. Because if you have the power plant, you can give light to as many people as you want to. Is that true? So you want the electricity. No, you want the power plant rather. Not just electricity in the house, but the power plant. So you are the one responsible, Elder Hoffman, to give power or electricity to everybody in town. Because you are the power plant in your house. Amen, somebody. Amen, somebody. You are the power plant, Sister Hoffman. Elder Clarence, you are the power plant, man. So it's time for to give power to everybody else. Because that's what the Lord says. I will empower you. I'll give it to you. Here's the last verse. The last text I want to use today is Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2 from verse 37. That my beautiful sister read for us earlier. Let's read that thing. From verse 37. Acts chapter 2. 37. Now when they heard this, they were what? Cut to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Then Peter said to them, repent and let every one of you be what? Baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Verse 39. I love that one. For the promise is to whom? To you and to your children and to all who are afar off, as many as the Lord our God will call. Has the Lord called you? Amen, somebody. I want to hear a hearty amen. Has the Lord called you? If the Lord has called you, the Lord says, the promise of the Holy Spirit, it is made unto you, or the promise is for you. The promise is for your children. The promise is for your grandchildren. The promise is for your great-grandchildren. The promise is for everyone that the Lord has called. regardless who you are, poor and rich, white and black and brown and gray and green, or whosoever you are. So, son, Adriana said, Pastor, there's no green people. You never know. So, brothers and sisters, the underline is that God will give the power to all of us. Amen? So the Lord says, now I want you to go and become a power plant wherever I send you. At your school, become a power plant. Give power to everybody else who is in darkness. This is what it means when Jesus says, I want you to be the light of the world. Amen? I want to be the light of the world. What about you? I want to be that. I want to become an encourager. I want to not only encourage somebody, I want to enlighten somebody. The same way that the Holy Spirit has enlightened me, has taught me, has instructed me, I also want to give a Bible study. You do not need to open your Bible to give a Bible study. You may pass out some books. Come on, somebody. Give some book to somebody. Give a great controversy. Give a step to Christ. Give a simple track to somebody. And guess what? You already teach somebody. Amen? So, brothers and sisters, if it is your desire to receive the Holy Spirit as your helper in everything in life that you're going through, I want you to stand with me. If you want the Holy Spirit to become your helper, because sometimes you feel like you need that help. You need somebody to help you. And you feel like human beings cannot help you. They can't help you enough. Your lawyer cannot help you enough. No way. Your financial officer cannot help you enough. Your finance cannot help you enough. Your health insurance, your Medicaid and Medicare cannot help you enough. You feel like the government has let you down. It's good that the government has let you down because the government cannot help you enough. So you need something. You need somebody who is greater, somebody who is higher, somebody who is better to help you out. You need that encourager. Not only as an adult, as a man, as a woman, as a young person, you need a helper in life. Your peers cannot help you enough. In reality, your peers will drive you astray. And next thing you know, you are at the port, you are at the door of hell. You're in trouble. But when the Holy Spirit is helping you, hallelujah, next thing you know, you'll be in heaven with Jesus Christ. Amen, somebody. If you want to enlighten somebody, stand with me. You want to enlighten somebody, you want to become a teacher. The Lord will teach you how to do it. You do not need to have a degree for that. The Lord will teach you how to teach somebody the word of God. Or if you want the Lord to empower you, I would like you to lift up your hand right now. Lift up your hand. If it is your desire, say to the Lord, empower me, please. Come on, let's pray the prayer with me. Empower me, Lord. Empower me with the Holy Spirit. 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 Father, let it be. Let it be, Father God. Empower me. Empower my brothers and my sisters. Empower anyone, Father God, who is listening right now. Empower us, Lord. Empower us. Empower us, Lord. Not just to serve you. Empower us to have a better relationship with you. Empower us to get to know you better. Empower us, Lord, to serve you better. Empower us to become more loving, more forgiving. Empower us, Father God, to become a better person. Empower us to know by your grace we will overcome, no matter what the devil does, no matter what other people do to drag us down. By the grace of God, draw us closer to you, we ask. In Jesus' name, amen. And amen. You may be seated. God bless you.
Spend too much time with your head down. What you're looking for might must be on the ground. Too many days living and telling the same old lies. This life's got you down. Decide you better believe there ain't nothing for you, nothing for you down here. So let me make it clear.